Now, first of all, I wanted to make a video to just answer some of the questions that I got recently, and it's very hard to just type answers. I know there are some really good tutorials out there and experts that are much more in-depth and have in-depth knowledge. I got some questions. Somebody asked me about how do you import or export or gravity sketch. Gravity sketch is a different beast. I have some gravity sketch, not even tutorials, more process explorations on the YouTube. I'm not making tutorials, but what I can do is at least show the flow of the creation of the pavilion. And first I'll go in a little bit into the mood boarding, so you can skip that part if you want to go straight to the blender, which is the second part. And then the third part, I'll just explain a little bit about the Unity setup and about the use of prefabs, the bakery, reflection probes, and some other topics, and mostly optimization. I think prefabs and optimization and understanding baked light, which I'm still not an expert on, is kind of at least touched upon in relation to the pavilion build. In this little overview video, I just wanted to give a glimpse of the making of the pavilion. And for the new builders that are joining in Mona Gallery, welcome. I'm not an absolute expert on Unity or on Blender or anything like that at all. I'm kind of still learning my way around, coming from more traditional industrial design packages, but spent some time game developing, made a game for iOS last year, and really enjoyed diving in 100% on the gallery. So what I'll show you is the three stages of designing. So this is the first stage, where kind of mood boarding, you know, getting a variety of like inspirations, cooking in a let me shrink this down a little bit here, from Pinterest and just all the graphic art that I love, the atmospheres, floating, you know, color palettes, things like that. So I just started, I had a bit of a vision, but I started with a kind of a metro station kind of concept in the beginning. Might be in here. Moebius is just one of my heroes, and as you can already see, this floating pool, you might recognize it a little bit, of this light coming out of this pool, was part of the inspiration. And there's always the warm and the cool, right? There's the cold of night and the blues, and then there's the warm of the warm light. Obviously, some form of a cruel scene, you know, that you see. Cruelty is a theme also in Blade Runner and movies like that, right? If you study deeply the storyline. Again, a Moebius piece, huge fan. So just this is actually a Blender piece that I made a while ago for my game, just quick, you know, low poly kind of modeling. And this was actually the initial concept I made for the Mona Gallery idea, and it looked a little bit like a pass-through station. So we still have the idea to make that central hub with the doors like Monsters Inc, so that you can go to all the different galleries. I still think that's a nice idea for the next one, maybe just a simple build that just has portals. It's just a space with some street art, and it just has portals. Maybe something like this could be really cool. So I'm sitting here. Okay, here you go. This was another quick build in Blender of that space. Again, trying to get the warm and the cold, you know, really get the lighting such that you have that contrast, clearly the inspiration of Moebius. And then I started sketching a lot in Concept Smarter Sketching, which is the iPad app that I use. iPad Pro, the pencil. So I do a lot on iPad Pro with a pencil with Concepts. This is the app that I use all the time. It's a beautiful color palette. It's beautiful for inspiration and putting things together and starting to create a board. And then there's the whole heritage story, in which I won't go into detail now. This is more about the techniques of Blender to Unity and some gravity sketch. So some more inspiration, older pieces I made. This is like 2010, maybe earlier, ZBrush. Oh, there you go, 2011, right? ZBrush and Photoshop. So I need to probably mint some of this stuff. Some of this you will find on the wall. 2016, Concept Smarter Sketching, Faster Horse. Obviously, I'm big into artificial intelligence, robotics. And this is an amazing artist that I found online. This is some stuff I did again, sketching, and then some mood boards of all my old Cinema 4D stuff. So this is Rhino. This is Photoshop ZBrush. This is like old work I did back in the day, and I should probably mint it sometime when I was very much into Cinema 4D and very much into ZBrushing and very much into just creating art for a while, and I didn't do much with it. Floating ships. But quickly wanted to swap over to, so here you see a quick sketch of the three mood boards and how I then created an artifact or a piece sketch in there. Not sure if I can zoom in. Yeah, you can zoom in a little bit actually. So you'll ah, crash. And we're back. Check the audio. So here you see how I kind of take a mood board and kind of do a very rough sketch, a quick line drawing and then some color, switch your layer management to automatic, and it'll immediately drop the fills on the right layers. That's the beauty of concepts. So quick little ship idea, that's the quick little the whale thing idea for in the middle. So you see the mood board and then into the vehicles, the concept work of where I wanted to go with this stuff. Then I usually kind of record some animations in concepts just by screen capture on the iPad Pro, and you can quickly kind of make little movies and stuff like that. So it's pretty pretty flexible to just record the process as well whilst you're doing it. So here you will see me in a very, very, very slow manner to start sketching a little bit, but I think that's perhaps not relevant. This is actually the recording of how I create those little sketches. Here you see it's just straight lines that just quickly from freehand kind of create these kind of little vehicles you see it happening there. Normally I would speed them up for a GIF or something like that for on social media. But let's dive into the real meat and of Blender, for instance. So here you see the vehicle being created. Yeah. Now there's already an early Blender shot, Unity shot. There's a later Unity shot. There's some art that we dropped in. And let's see. Yeah, this is already a little bit more advanced. I created a little bit of a kind of a semi-brand image that I could drop onto the space here and there. And here you see the result that later on in the process, right? This is concepts, by the way, concept smarter sketching. So with that, let's go into Blender, and then for those of you that don't know, I have Unity open here to the right, and you can see the space that is the one that we're talking about here. This is what I call the Pavilion 2039, so we'll have a look at that in a little bit. My favorite, absolute favorite setting is this, baked. So you go to bake light map, and then you can see already how much the baking really influences the overall atmosphere, right? So when you want to just put it in the background, I usually maybe park it in a wireframe or something like that. So let's have a look at Blender. I'm still pretty much learning Blender. I come from Rhino and stuff like that. I also do quite a lot of gravity sketch, but what you see here is actually the initial we are recording, yeah, the initial build of the space, not the initial, probably version 2 or 3, sorry. And what I do quite early on is normally get a little bit of some good lighting going with a few Studio World, maybe a hard, a warm light and a cool light. And I don't really see the cool light. Oh, it's all warm at the moment. Okay. Yeah. Normally I put in like a little bit of a cool. Yeah. You see it there, right? So just a few point lights already, like drop the cool one in and drop the warm, just like we saw in the Moebius kind of images. And immediately that gives you a flavor of your lighting will set the tone in conceptually of what you might be wanna, where you might wanna go with it. So then as far as the space, if I just do edit mode, you'll notice it's not a highly advanced high def at all. It's actually really basic. I'm not an advanced modeler, but I wanted to create lightweightness all the way through so that in the end I could optimize more easily. And as you can see, most pieces are actually part of the part of extrusions, things like that. Starting with a very simple shape, the bridges are integrated, everything's integrated and relatively similar in its kind of build. And that you can just start with a cube or a plane and just start kind of slowly building your way out and slowly extruding some pieces like this, extrude out or extrude and scale, you know, very simple and mostly keeping it clean, no overlapping corners, no weirdness. I usually would also create some chamfers. I started doing that quite a lot in Gravity Sketch to learn how to do simple chamfers, because that will really work in your favor once you start rendering. You need those lights to hit a chamfer to really look beautiful. But in this case, the scene has come forward from a very simple, I think my camera perspective, I'm really bad at cameras in Blender at the moment still, just a very simple thing. And then usually what you go is to UV editing. You select the whole thing. You have your, you should have your texture selected. There's not even a material on here, okay. And if you select all, there it is. Then you see this very standard, simple, smart UV project. I didn't go much further than that. I didn't optimize it that much at all. Simply because I was not the expert and I didn't have the time. It was a sprint of a couple of weeks. So it's smart UV project. Just by selecting all your object and going to smart UV project, it's a fairly easy way to get a quick, decent mapping. That then you will obviously, I don't understand why there's no material connected to this even. But normally I would create a material, right, and go into shading and then have a look at what the material is. Now I did a fairly basic material, probably may not even have mapped anything on it, because all I wanted to do is export this to Unity and then bring in some concretes or some materials there. And I'm completely noob on really doing high grade materials. When I do it, I usually use other people's PBR libraries or things like that and map them on and kind of finagle it. So I'm not the expert, I'm still learning there. But as long as the good UV unwrap has happened, you have a decent chance at getting it into Unity correctly. So let's continue. What else did I have? I have the pavilion. Now the pavilion, as you can see, is gonna select objects, go into Z. What's going on here? Texture paint. I'm not into modeling, I'm into texture paint for some reason, sorry. Go into Z, and there you can see the pavilion. Now again, it should be a fairly simple build, but I think I actually did some UV, let me hide the Teatrico here for a minute. I actually did some UV coloring here. Why is it not on edit mode? If I go to UV editing or texture paint, and it doesn't show my texture. Oh, it's still mirrored, so it's actually still a mirror. So this is built as a quad piece of a mirror. So in that case, anything you do in one of these corners, if you're modeling, if you're in edit mode, you see happens in all four corners. It's a really good way to set that up in the beginning. You make a cube, split it in four, delete three corners, and only work on one corner with a XY mirror. And you set that up here. Oh, I'm sorry. You cannot see the entire screen. Well, that's a great video. You set that up. I hope you were able to see the other one. Here in the, so you simply go delete. You simply go add modifier, look up the mirror. And then you do X and Y, you see? So if you do X alone, you get that. And Y, you get that. And you can actually apply it to a certain moment or just work like that. So it's a very fast way to build. And usually I would keep this open and then go to Unity. If I need to make edits, I go back. In the end of the day, you want to have it be UV. Select all. No, we're in object mode. Yeah, here you see it's actually not really properly. Let me do a proper UV smart project. I think I have more than one object selected. Sorry. You You see, I'm not really prepared to do a real tutorial. I'm just showing you a little bit the way of how it was built. Now if I do this and I just select that top part, this is the layout of the grid. And I actually think I had a material selection on there that gives you the glow. So if we go back to modeling, go to just the top lid part. It's been a while that I built this and I kind of improvised my way through these things. And you see here two materials. One material is on the normal kind of, it's just the base orange. And then there's the emissive that actually gives you the emissive strength from 0 to 100. And you can apply that to a certain group. And then that actually exports out. So I export it as FBX. And then you can go straight to the Unity. It's not a detailed tutorial. It's just an overview of kind of how I built these pieces. And for detailed Blender tutorials, there's obviously a lot to learn, and I'm still learning myself. Okay, on that note, let me stop this part and go to the next part. Okay. For the next section, so if we switch on the Teatrico again, I had an idea also where you could port from one of these kind of parts there and actually go all the way, loop back into the pool. Tried it, worked with it, and in the end I couldn't get it to work. So it's like one of those ideas that didn't make it in the end. So I haven't done that. So this is basically it. Let's switch to... And most things I just keep in this Blender file and I kind of like keep them there. Let's see what else we have here. Oh yeah, don't save. And then here you see a LiDAR piece. So let's see, fingers crossed, if these textures are still there. Yes. So this is LiDAR brought into, let me do it full screen here. No, that's too big. You need to be able to see a little bit of the. So basically what it is the LiDAR scan from my uncle's library, or my uncle's atelier, decimated. And decimated means you simplify it to the max. And with decimate, you can really destroy it, but in a good way, because it allows you to give you less, but still something. Less is more. So let's say I do this and I have a look at it. The texture remains intact. So that's the cool thing. If I do this, as you can see, flawless texture. And then I can see face count, a number face count there, that is now 2500. So then I can work with it and say, hey, it's kind of a blown up exploded thing, but this is all this is a LiDAR scan straight from the back of this iPad Pro. So experimentation, but I wanted to kind of import some of these experiences into the Mona gallery. And all I did is also clean it up. So you simply go in and you can literally go and delete some stuff. Then it always asks you, what do you want to delete? Only faces, edges, faces. I never know, this is kind of a weird question to me because I want to just delete everything there. Doesn't do it, so you gotta go again, don't save. Faces, okay, gotta go again. Oh, what do I don't know, only faces, vertices. So it's kind of annoying. Now I'm sure there's a trick, people are laughing saying, hey Bart, you have to do this. Sure. Delete it and make it less heavy, and at the end of the day your decimate is obviously not clean. It's definitely not clean stuff, but I was quite surprised when I was in the gallery that it actually gave you this impression of the warmth and the materials and things like that. So for me it's like start zero base level, and then in the next few years as graphics cards go up and as optimization continues, we can really capture spaces, capture memories, right? That's what this was about. So that's just a quick note on the LiDAR pieces. With that note, let me put this on wireframe to save my machine from making a lot of noise, and then optimize the Unity screen for you for your viewing, so that you can actually view it. Now I have the project. One moment, please. I have the projects on icons, which is okay, but you can also do it on lists. Might be a little better. Okay, so now let's have a look. So you have your artifacts, your portals, your space, and under space is where most of it's happening, and under artifacts, obviously. Let's switch. So my, like I said, my absolute favorite mode is, of course, baking, the bake map. So I run bakery, we're here on the right. And as soon as you put one of these objects in the inspector, not to static, interesting. That's the entire space. So, as you can see, I have a lot of small sidetrack. I have a lot of prefabs. And a prefab is simply something that you can use over and over and over and over again. So for instance, this Balkan and plafond, hitting F, I know where it is, means it's Dutch for these ceiling blocks. And if it's a prefab, right, I can reuse it and keep editing it. So if I make an edit to this and I overwrite, it's saved somewhere here. I'm not all up to speed as to where all my stuff is currently. It's a fairly complex structure. Keep your structure well organized, obviously. With a prefab, I can now simply, let's see where it is in the, you need to know where it is, Balkan plafond, so that is in folder space Balkan plafond. So I go to space folder, and there it is. So should I bring another one in there and I make a change on the first one? So I go in, I open it up, and now I'm inside of there, and I say, scale this bulk beam, it's called the beam, by so much. You will notice if I go back out that all of them have had this change. Therefore, but now should I want to make a unique one, then I can either do unpack prefab, or I can do the change like so, move this one up a little bit, go to that menu, and you see the override menu appearing. That's where you can choose what prefabs remain unique, or should I apply it to all. So it's a, it, once you get the hang of using prefabs, it becomes an extremely powerful way of managing your structure in your entire scene, no matter how complex. But it's extremely risky, because if you press something that's override, something else can break and go wrong, right? So be very careful with a structure. I also use it as a fuller structure in my hierarchy. And it actually does work that way. So once you do that, you can click and have this whole space. For example, you drop this entire space hierarchy, if you wanted to, in here. There's already one there, so I won't do it now. That space, sorry, my videos and my head's in the way. Don't need to see that. That space object, you can right click and export as a package. So now you can start creating packages that are clean build things, elements for other projects as well. It's a great way to transfer things from one to the next. So make sure you understand prefabs very well and use them. Now obviously my Balkan plafond is screwed, but I will not be saving it now. So that's an important part of organization and structure. The Mona space template has structure, so you stick to that. It took me a while to figure out this artifact prefab minting stuff. Stick to the rules of the game for those guys. And actually, if I don't want to save it, it's quite simple. I go to another scene. Do I have another scene? There's not that many scenes here. Tessellation simples, save, no. Now you're good. Go back to the other space. Go back to the pavilion, if you can, and find your scene. And I haven't been here for a while, but I think it's space. Yes. So then nothing's saved. So in a nutshell, you import all those elements. Ah yes, the bulk has become super, super large. So I did actually screw that up. So I'm gonna quickly fix that bulk. Have that crazy bulk. What I can do is actually copy component from this one, copy component of scale and location, and then pick the bad dude, and then actually go paste component value, and then it should be the same as the other ones. It might just need to be moved to its new position. So copy component value is a super nice way of getting back in the swing of things.